Hi, it's Mani Navasothy, Pagan, Wiccan, scientist, psychologist. I'm here in this particular video to talk about one of the crucial policies, rules, ideals in Wicca, if you like. And it's the one that's called "Anit harm none, do what you will." Basically, it means that as long as you're not harming anyone or anything, you can do whatever you like. This is quite an important thing that Wiccans aspire to, and I'm going to say they aspire to. And I'm also going to say that it's not a rule, it's a guideline. Because you try living in the world and just going about your really peaceful, harmonious life without trying to harm or causing any kind of hurt or pain to other people or other living creatures. I'm going to give you really easy examples that everybody quotes, and I'm going to throw some of my own examples as well. For example, just walking in the woods, as I've just done now. Walking in the woods, you know, you're going to be trodding on a whole lot of stuff. You are going to be walking on ant nests, worms and insects, things that are just below the surface that you can't see, but the moment you step on it, crush, life's gone, or some other being. And never mind that, just what about the stuff that you eat, you know? What about the stuff that you breathe, the air? It's got bacteria and viruses and all sorts of things in it. The moment you take in some food which has got all those microorganisms into your system, you know, your body's acids and defense systems jump on it and start, you know, dissolving it, killing it with powerful acids and all kinds of things like that. So the food, the bacteria, you know, it's made, you know, it's all cleared out. I mean, some of them get through, and that's where we get infections and disease and things like that. But the air we breathe, just breathing, okay, or just drinking water or just eating is killing other creatures. You know, I know that's kind of a really ridiculous example, and it's a bit pedantic, and I think the parrots agree as well. Well, I mean, they weren't even native to United Kingdom, London. They're from my country, probably India, and somebody probably released it 20, 30 years ago, and now they're all over the place. So, going back to the very act of breathing and eating and drinking, just, you know, even in the most peaceful way, is actually harming and killing other life forms. And the very act of walking is doing that. Okay, you might think that's like extreme examples, even though I like extreme examples to kind of illustrate the point. More of an ordinary example. Okay, you know, I'm going to an interview in for a new job. You know, there's 20 people, 30 people, maybe 200 these days. The competition is really high. So everybody's going for this interview, this one particular post, and that's, you know, say I'm going for it and it's going to really change my life, or maybe some other guy or girl is going for it, and that's going to really change their life and their family. They can sort their debts out, they can kind of have a comfortable life, they can feed their kids and they look after their parents, grandparents and their community and all sorts of things like that. So the implication of one person getting a job really is beneficial to a whole community group around that person. That's always the case, okay? So, you know, if I'm one of 200 people looking for a job, and there's other people as well, supposing I get that job, I hope I do, and supposing somebody else who's got the more skills or whatever and the experience gets it, brilliant for that person, their family. And the other 199 people, or the other 19 people, or whatever the number that who didn't get the job, what's happening to them and their families and their lives? So those people are suffering. Just the fact that, you know, somebody goes fair and square to an interview process and a selection process and gets a job means that all the others who didn't get it are actually going to suffer, you know. So does that mean that this person shouldn't get the job? Because they need to, you know, it's their own survival, their own security. So even something as simple as that is harming other people. Even though we think that we don't, and this is an example I use all the time in my courses and workshops. So this harming thing is not as easy as it sounds, and it's quite a difficult one to maintain, and that's why we aspire to it, and that's why it's actually a guideline. And sometimes, I mean, soldiers, you know, warriors, hunters, I don't mean hunters who just go around killing animals and people and, you know, murderers and things like that, but just soldiers who have to protect the land, boundaries. You know, army, navy, all these kind of people who are protecting a country, they all have to do things do things that are going to hurt and harm people. Politicians, you know, doctors, engineers, everybody is making decisions that's hurting somebody or other at some point or other. It's very difficult. So as magicians are saying, oh no, you know, we mustn't do anything that's going to harm other people, it's an impossibility. Literally an impossibility. It can't be held 100%. It cannot be followed. It can only be an aspiration. And my take on it is that it applies more importantly to magic. Because the way I see it, not everybody, everybody's probably born with intuition, probably with psychic abilities and magic, but not everybody is aware of it, not everybody's practicing it. So those of us who are practicing it have a kind of an advantage as well as a responsibility. And so for those people, using the use of magic, esoteric knowledge, which means hidden knowledge, or occult knowledge, which means also secret knowledge, we are using a particular skill that is quite important, that's powerful, and that can reach anybody. You know, most people are bound by, you know, physical connections to influence somebody else, but a magician, a real powerful magician, just sit here and do something that could potentially impact on somebody else on the other side of the planet, and nobody can even pin it down, nobody can track it back. So it's like a really powerful thing to be able to do magic. And that's why the "and it harm and do as you will" applies even more so to us magicians, because we have a bigger responsibility and we must use it wisely. And so when we are doing magic, are we doing it for ourselves? Are we doing it for somebody else's benefit? Are we taking money for it? Are we doing it for the better of the land, the community, the world? These issues come into play, and weighing it all up before doing a particular bit of magic is a very, very tough thing to do. And, you know, there is no easy answer. There's no rule. There's no simple solution. There's no formula to telling you or me or anybody how to use magic and not harm anybody. It's each person must take that responsibility for themselves. Each person must live with the consequences of the action they take as a result of using magic in that way. And that's ongoing. That's just like forever, 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 forever. This life and possibly next lives, if you believe in karma and reincarnation as well. So that's the most important thing I want to say about "and it harm, and do as you will." Take it as a guideline, as a high ideal aspiration, more for magician ritualists, or people who've got occult knowledge, and then how they use that and how they go forward with that. So I think that's enough for this particular topic, and I'm just going to say thank you for watching this. Do subscribe to my videos on my YouTube channel, and I also have pages like Pagan Frontiers of London, Wicca, Witchcraft and Magic, Gaian Times. Those are some of my pages. My blog is QuantumPhoenix.net. On YouTube channel you can look for my name, Mani Navasothy, or you can look for Gaian 2012. That used to be my name and I changed it, which has got all those magical esoteric kind of things. There's a lot of noise now. There's a lot of birds going around, crows and parrots and things, so I'm going to take a short break. I'm going to have a little bit of breakfast. I bought some food and things to sit in the park and do, and then I'm going to be doing another. I just realized it's quite interesting how the light hits my face through the leaves, and how it kind of camouflages my face, like army people do. You know, they kind of use paint to break up the contours of the face so they can be not recognized easily. And at the moment, look at that, you know, the light from the leaves is doing that to me. Whoops, I just seen the sun and I can't blind. Alright, thank you for watching. Take care.